Hello. In this video, we will study the so-called dual space of a normed linear space. And the space is defined as the space of all bounded linear functionals on X, along with the addition and scalar multiplication of operators, and together with the operator norm. And as our first observations regarding the space, we can note that the dual space is always a Born space, even if the space X is itself not complete, since we can recall that the space of bounded operators is complete whenever the image space, in this case the space of complex numbers, is a complete space. And as we saw before, the Hahn-Bahn theorem implies that the dual space is non-trivial whenever the space X itself contains non-zero elements. Dual spaces are quite an important tool in the study of normed spaces and Born spaces. It's also possible to identify dual spaces of concrete normed spaces. One of the most classical of such cases are the Lebesgue spaces, whose duals can be identified with other Lebesgue spaces. The result stated here, which also generalizes to the case of functions of several variables, shows that if the exponent p is finite and strictly greater than 1, then the dual space of Lp is isometrically isomorphic with another Lebesgue space LQ. And here the exponent Q is determined by the condition that 1 over P plus 1 over Q is equal to 1. And as we recall, we can think of two isometrically isomorphic normed spaces to be the same space. And this way we can more simply express the result that the dual of Lp is Lq when p is finite and greater than 1. In particular, the condition here shows that the space L2 is its own dual. On the other hand, if p is exactly equal to 1, then the dual of L1 is the space L infinity of essentially bounded measurable functions, but on the other hand, dual of L infinity is a strictly larger space than L1. The proof of the result for the case where P is greater than 1 has the following main steps. First of all, we can observe that for any function g in LQ, we can define a functional phi g on LP whose value is given by the integral of the product of f and g for any f in the space LP. Indeed, this mapping is clearly linear, and it's also well defined and bounded as a consequence of the Hölder inequality. On the other hand, a deeper result, the so-called Radon-Nikodym theorem, states that every functional on LP, in fact, has this same integral form for some function g in LQ. And in the final part of the theorem, we show that the mapping from the function g in LP to the functional phi g is in fact an isometric isomorphism between the spaces LQ and the dual of LP. In particular, the surjectivity of this mapping follows from the second step and the Radon-Nikodym theorem, which states that all functionals on LP are in the range of this mapping. A similar result also holds for the spaces of p-summable sequences. Also in this case, the dual of LP is another space LQ, whenever p is finite and strictly larger than 1, and the dual of L1 is L infinity. Moreover, the dual of L infinity is again a space which is strictly larger than L1. And with dual spaces, we can go a step further and note that since the dual space is a norm space, we can also define the dual of the dual, which becomes the so-called second dual, or sometimes called bidual, of the space X. The second dual turns out to have the property that it always contains an isometrically isomorphic copy of the original space X as a subspace. The underlying reason for this property is quite simple. If X is a fixed element of our space, we can define a mapping from the dual space of X in such a way that every functional phi in the dual space, this mapping produces the value of phi at the point X. In other words, our mapping psi X evaluates every functional phi at the point X. The linearity and boundedness of psi x for every fixed element x are quite easy to prove, and because of this, psi x is indeed a bounded linear functional on the dual space of x, which makes it an element of the bidual. Furthermore, based on this construction, we can also define the so-called evaluation map, J, which relates every element x with the corresponding functional psi x, which we just defined. And this mapping from x to the second dual turns out to be isometric, and because of this, the space X is going to be isometrically isomorphic to the range of J, which is a subspace of the second dual. The second dual and the evaluation map are especially important in defining the property called reflexivity of a normed space. And indeed, as we just saw, the range of the evaluation map J is always a subspace of the second dual, but in general, it's not necessary that the range would cover the whole space. However, there is an important and extremely nicely behaving class of normed spaces for which the range of J is exactly the second dual, and these are called reflexive spaces. And since the evaluation map is always an isometric, and since the second dual is a Banach space, all reflexive spaces are by definition complete. For the same reason, reflexive space is also always isometrically isomorphic to its second dual, but in fact the condition of reflexivity is strictly stronger than this, and in particular it is possible that a space which is isometrically isomorphic to its second dual is not reflexive. As already mentioned, reflexive spaces can be considered to be quite nice Banach spaces, and they do possess certain stronger properties than general norm spaces do. In our earlier example case, both the Lebesgue spaces and the sequence spaces LP are reflexive precisely if the exponent is finite and greater than 1. Our earlier result on duals of these spaces already implies that in the case where P is either equal to 1 or infinity, the space cannot be reflexive since in these cases the spaces are not isometrically isomorphic to their second duals. On the other hand, if P is greater than 1, the spaces and their second duals are isometrically isomorphic, but proving the stronger property of reflexivity requires additional work. In the case of the Lebesgue space LP, the proof uses the special properties of the mapping of a function LQ in LQ to the function of phi g, which we already saw in our previous proof. And we also recall that the surjectivity of this mapping was based on the Radom-Nikodym theorem, and improving reflexivity, this correspondence between a Lebesgue space and its and a dual of another Lebesgue space is used 2 times. In the end, we will be able to show that every functional psi on the second dual of LP necessarily has the form of an evaluation, meaning that it maps the functional phi on the dual of x to the value of the functional at a given function h in LP. And this shows that evaluation map J is indeed surjective. And as the final topic of the video, we can come back to the concept of a completion of a normed space. The full definition states that a Banach space Y is a completion of a normed linear space X if X is isometrically isomorphic to a dense subspace of Y. When defined this way, it turns out that every normed space X has a completion which is unique up to an isometric isomorphism between the different completions. And the reason why it's a good time to consider this topic again is that dual spaces give us one way of constructing the completion of a vector space. And indeed, if X is a normed space, then one description of its completion is that it is the closure of the range of the evaluation map in the second dual together with the norm of the second dual of X. To see that this space is indeed a completion of X, it suffices to note that it is first of all a Banach space, because it is by definition a closed subspace of the second dual, which is a Banach space. And moreover, X is isometrically isomorphic to the range of J, as we already saw, and the range of J is of course a subspace of the closure of the range. Finally, by definition of a closure, the range of J is also dense in the closure.